All right, ready to go? Okay, cool. Hello, everybody. Okay, for our next session, we've got building a REST job server for interactive Spark as a service with Romain Rigaud from Cloudera.
Thank you. Cool. So hi, everybody. I'm Romain. I work on Hue at Cloudera. And today, I'm going to explain a way how to build a REST server to make Spark usable from anywhere. You will notice that our colleague Eric couldn't make it, but it should still be fun. I have a bunch of slides that goes pretty quick. Then we'll do a short demo to show that it works. And then we'll have like a few minutes for questions. So first, why? Why Spark as a service? So we work on Hue. So we make Hadoop. We want to make Hadoop easier to use. The type of users really like to type in the shell, to do explorations. This is an example of work count. Some other users, they prefer to have a nice UI where they can type. If you do a mistake, you can go back. You can also have like quick shortcuts or like auto completion. You can link tables. You can have a quick, nice graph. You can see your running jobs. It's a bit nicer. So if you make like a web app, you enable a web app to talk to any Spark. You also get for free like exit access from anywhere. You can also share context. If you share a Spark shell somewhere, you have like a running context remote. You can build apps on top of REST APIs. I will also show some demos that Microsoft is working on too. Why Spark and Hue? So Hue already has a UI for all the Hadoop components. So in one click, you can drag and drop a file. It will create a Hive table or a Solar Index for you. Same, you can look at your jobs. You can just do autocomplete for almost everything. As Spark is becoming a bigger component of Hadoop, it's why we're adding support for it. We started actually a while ago, like 2 or 3 years ago, with a mock-up of this app. We're just using Uzi. So we're generating a workflow, Uzi workflow with a shell action. So you could type some Python, like on the right, submit to Uzi. It was taking 10, 15 seconds, then just dumping the output. So not really good. Bit more than 1 year ago, we used Oyala job server. So it was better, tiny bit more interactive. But still, you had to implement an interface. It was like Scala or Java only. You had to compile, jar, upload, and submit, like really batch style. You do a mistake, you need to redo all the process again, compile, upload, batch. So early this year, we started to do some iterations, how to do like Spark in a notebook with a new type of server that supports everything you can do in regular Spark. So Spark Submit on all the Spark shells. This is a general architecture. As it is a REST API, it can go from like a web app or like a user, and I will always focus on the REST server in this talk. So this server is written in Scala. It's open source. It lives in the Hue repository for now. There's no dependency on you. If you just run the REST server, it's there for you. And it's a wrapper around the Spark Summit and all the Spark shell. So we're not redoing the wheel. We're just wrapping it up, making it available in Hadoop. We work in local mode on yarn mode for better scalability. And like as a third point, one of the biggest advantages, you can just take the program you're running right now with Spark Summit, don't touch anything. Or all the code you just type in your shell, you can run it with the REST API. And I will explain a bit more what I say when it can be extended to talk with other like backends. So higher level for Livy, which is the name of the REST server. We have local mode, it's more like dev mode. It means you can have some clients on the same machine, on the other machine. Say, I want to run some like snippets of Python, like in a PySpark shell. Client will do REST post request, go through Livy. We use a mini like web server from Scala, then talk to the session manager, then do I want a Spark, a Scala shell, or a batch session. Go through it, then we'll boot an interpreter for you. See the little orange, so we add some magic for communicating back and forth with it, also to do magic keywords that I will detail in just a tiny bit. When the Spark contest is up, we just return, say to the client, it's ready. You can already start typing or submitting your code. Most interesting, the yarn cluster mode, contrary to just the client mode. So same, you can have a client anywhere, talk to the REST server. REST server will do the same as just before. Then ask yarn, oh, I want to run like my Spark interpreter in the little Livy wrapper somewhere in the cluster. So this is a yarn app. So it's not on the client machine. So if on the left I reboot or I kill it or I lose the machine, still, my job will still be running. And it will be more scalable. I can have a lot of jobs because they don't run on the machine. When the Spark is up, it will be the same as the yarn cluster mod. It will like spawn, go on some other yarn nodes, get the worker out. And when this is already set up, returns, we give the ID back to the client. For the client, it's really easy. If I want to just to start a Scala shell, I just do a post type, post Spark, Spark. I get the ID. I see ID 0. And then by just doing a pushing to the ID slash testments, some snippet of codes, they will be executed automatically in the remote interpreter. And then I get the data back. So this is cool. So we do sessions on batches. The difference is really just the interpreter we are running, like the embedded interpreter. Can be just Spark Spark for session, or batch, it would be like the Spark semi-command under the cover. The interpreters, so if we drill down in this little blue box, this is mostly 80% of the difficult part of the project are the interpreters. If we drill in this, we want to pipe code in and just get the result out, and it's an interpreter. So if you type in the shell, you get just some text back. So we want to be a bit smarter. All the range I put later will be like the magic tweaking that we need to add in the interpreter to do more smarter things. And this interpreter is one by language, and they can be swappable. The flow, basically, if I just type in my notebook like 1 plus 1, like the UI will send like some little JSON, the interpreter will get the 1 plus 1. Then it might or might not do some magic around it, then execute the 1 plus 1, send it back, send it, leave it sent with a nice MIME type to the client. It can display it. So it's pretty simple. The difficult part is like we need to parse it in the back end. I put a link to an example directly in the code base. I won't go too deep into it. But if you have a snippet, a bunch of lines, you need to execute chunks and then look if there is a magic keyword, like a percent table, percent JSON, execute it. Then either one, if you define a class, if you do an exec, or you need to be aware of this. Then you have this little read eval loop. And I'm going to detail the magic part. Magic is common in most of the other notebook applications. If you just do like 1 plus 1, it's good, but you just get text back. In this case, just a number. But if you are doing a print, you will just get like a bunch of text in output. So not super useful. So in the interpreter, so in the blue part, what we are doing, we are just doing an exec of the code. The shell is the blue. The magic is orange. So we don't need to do anything fancy here. So we will get two that we'll send back. However, if we do a little work count, instead of just printing what's in the button, like in the text, we want to send something that can be displayed more easily by the front end. So we execute on the left the code. Then we can do some introspection in the shell. So with Spark, you can get the value of a variable. And then let's say we just poke it and extract it, JSONify. And instead of just returning some plain text, we return like a JSON output. It's the same with tables. Tiny bit smarter, because like in SQL, SQL table, you usually have headers with a type. So we need to guess the type automatically of the columns. And then we send that back to the client. And it's for this, in the notebook, we can do nice graphing. Because in the backend, we get like data really easy to display. Plotting, so a bit more advanced. Let's say we want to plot like in R, like bar plot. What we're doing, instead of just having the plot running somewhere in the interpreter, we need to catch the image somehow. So what we do, we rewrite a bit the code. So we are cheating a bit. In the orange part, the magic part, we insert save PNG, then send the plot command, save it to a file. So we'll send that to the blue, to the real shell. When the shell is done, we'll just read it, and then we'll send back to the front end or to the client, just encode it. That way we get the image. Because all of this is running somewhere in the cluster, and we need to grab it. Livy, by default, supports Spark by Spark R interpreters. To make it even more robust, we're currently working in testing it with IPython Jupyter, which has a bunch of kernels that we could talk to. We just need to implement their protocol. And Livy is designed from the start to be pluggable with these backends. So now that we saw how to build like a remote shell context somewhere and how we can make it a bit nicer for clients, what can we do with it? So right now, if one user has one notebook, we have three clients, there are three interpreters. Nothing prevents them, actually, to just share them. So we can have three clients. If they talk to the same session, like session slash zero, they will talk to the same remote shell somewhere in the cluster. If you have an interpreter, you can create some RDDs. You can do more than one. You can do a bunch. So it means this client can also share RDDs or the context. If we want it to be a bit cleaner, we'll have to manage all the authentication authorization, so plug it, the Livy server itself, then all the agents that we send in the cluster, we'll have to do something similar. So now we have like a bunch of clusters, a bunch of clients that can just proxy all their Spark commands through Livy, and somewhere in the cluster, they will be executed. Or they can talk to the same one or not the same one. This is a little demo that I will live demo, just a tiny bit of explanation before. So I started a remote shell somewhere in the cluster, like a PySpark shell. In this shell, I have a RDD. This RDD is a really simple one. It's the most simple you can do. To make it a bit more convenient, I'm just embedding it in a dictionary. That way, I can do set and get on my RDD. I will show the code later. It's really simple. So now, I have my running shell somewhere in the cluster. If I just do some curl to the same session, like session zero, and I send a snippet of code, that in our case, oh, get the name of this variable, do a get of this key. It's going to just return the key. I could even make it a bit nicer, just to avoid the post. We could even wrap all the posts like in Python with the request library. Then you just specify the session, the name of the variable, the remote RDD you want to talk to. And then you can just interact, like if you have like a local dictionary. But in practice, it could be like a big, like giant RDD key value store somewhere running the cluster. I will switch, so now, to live demo. So I'm just going to log into Hue. I'm using the latest. I will use a tiny bit of notebook, but then run a bunch of curl commands. So I have Livy server running locally for the purpose of the demo. I'm just going to restart it. Then Livy is going to wait for clients. Here's just a PySpark snippet. So what's happening? First time, we're going to do all the yarn creation of a remote PySpark shell somewhere in the cluster. So it's booting a yarn job. I can curl all my sessions. So it's in starting state. It just switched to idle. If I do slash zero, it will just go to select only this session. Idle means the session is ready to get some commands, and you already executed it. So it works much faster the second time. I'm running yarn. So if I open the job browser, I can see my yarn somewhere, Spark session running. This is a Spark wrapper. It's not the exact the executor. And I could see so the Spark itself, the Spark UI. I can run more complicated things, like just count a bit. I will see like the Spark UI with update accordingly. So more interestingly, if you play with magic keywords, so here, if what I will do if I just I was typing a list in a shell, but with introspection, if I do like a table of my variable, I will get a grid of data. And then for this, we get for free like all the graphics we have already built in into Hue. Same, I can type any type of snippets. We support all the iServer2 API, all the JBC. So if I run also an Impala query in the same notebook, I will get my data. Same data, it looks like a table, but I can plot it. And all these widgets, I can also plot it based on my Spark shell automatically. Because as soon as I have a table data, I can print them. If I kill Livy, so I just stopped it, the session will still be running because we did like a Spark submit. So my Yarn job, Spark job, will still be running in Yarn. So if I want to kill it, I can just kill it for real in the UI. If I go back to the example, like where we could share RDDs, actually, I'm going to open it here. So this is just my little context. I just added a get on a set. So it's really not efficient. It's really a proof of concept. Maybe I can zoom a bit. Up. So I'm just going to start it. I need to start Livy again. So same, I'm going to start my remote shell somewhere, so PySpark shell. So I'm just doing creating a class, defining a class. And when it's ready, I can do a few set on get. And in the meantime, I will prepare follow-up snippet. So I have my Spark somewhere in the cluster. So I just instantiate the class, put two values. Then I can just get the data. We can see the counter. We have a one Yarn job running somewhere. The interesting part now, if I just take like a notebook, like a Python notebook, that I will just explain a tiny bit. I just start a new notebook. And we just added support for just importing all your notebook. So I just import it. And basically what we do is just super simple. Like just the curl is just boilerplate code to send a post request, like a curl in Python. I just say RDD is like the variable name in my shell. Then I can just do a get of any value. So we are doing the same as this. Like the value, the variable is states. And value is, like for example, Alaska. And instead of running it here, we just plain Python, talking REST. I can just like open a normal Python. I think it's session, might not be session one. So my session is not working. It died. But anyway, you can just do the curl itself in the notebook. And last mini example. So I'm just using from LucidWorks Spark Solar. So how to do a Spark streaming to pull some tweets in live, put it in a Solar index. Same with Livy. It's super easy. I can just do a post want to zoom a bit. Oops. Up. So I do a post, point to my jar, put the class name, then I need to point to a solar somewhere. I just post it, so I'm doing a batch job. So it's not running a shell, it's doing like a Spark submit of a jar. I can see my jar is already running. I'm going to just do a quick check in the browser. OK, it's running. So I just use a Solar Search app. You can see the tweet coming. You can even auto-refresh every 4 seconds. And then my Spark streaming job running somewhere in the cluster is just dumping tweets into my index. And then I can just look only tweets from the US, build a search dashboard. So it's really, really easy. I could submit this one, I'm not going to show, but with a notebook to launch the same command. Is this one? It's almost the same as what I typed in the shell. You just do it from the UI. So that was the demo. And like the code for the shard ID is just in the bottom, and we have some blog posts that expand a bit more what I just did, a bit more less condensed. So security in Livy, so we're working on it a lot. We did SSL support just this week. We're working. Well, now if I kill Livy, I restart it. My job is still running, but Livy won't know it's still there. So we need to persist the state, like in the database. Kerberos support will be important for GA. Microsoft people are building some cool extension for Python based on Livy. Basically, you just run. You can look more on the GitHub, but run a Jupyter notebook, and just you can point to any cluster anywhere. Like they added like a SparkConf keyword that points to Livy, and so you can point to any REST server anywhere and just type your queries. Future, so Rhino is in queue. It's not dependent on you. We might move it out if we get more activity. Same is all open source. It's in beta. We have already a lot of people asking questions and playing with it. Security working on it. We want to work more closely to Jupyter. They have cool backends, and we don't want to redo everything again. Shared RDD, so it was more a POC, so for cool demos. We'll see, we could think that we could have some nice URLs, like REST URLs, to like, oh, I want to share this RDD, or I want to like discover list of named RDDs, play with them. Could be added into Livy, could be built into Spark, I don't know. And all of this also, the notebook is going to be bumped even more. We're redesigning it in Hue, in the upcoming big revamp of Hue, so it will be even slicker. I put the Jira, the current main umbrella Jira for Livy, the Spark server. Just a cheat sheet with Livy for later, if people want to play a bit, get more info, and compare it. And that's it. So thank you, everybody. If you have some questions, feel free to ask now. I will stay a bit here, then I will go to the Cloudera booth or outside the room. On any time on Twitter user list, feel free to ping us. Thanks a lot.
So for anybody who has questions, raise your hands, and I'll run over there. Questions? I think we're good then.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
All right.